I'm here today with Congresswoman Kendra Horn, who represents Oklahoma's 5th District in the U.S. Congress. Well, I know one of the big things that as a congressperson you do is asking the federal government for emergency relief. Kind of tell us briefly how that process works and what you've done in the past.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the governor has declared a state of emergency as a state. But the next step is to get a federal emergency declaration. And I'm working with my colleagues in the delegation, leading a letter to let the governor know that that we're here to assist in getting additional federal resources as necessary. And he has to request a federal disaster declaration. So we're working together on that. And you're right, we've been able to help in previous instances. I think one of the examples that that I've talked about and that many people may know about is the bridge in Jones that was in very near danger of having to be closed, their bridge to their middle school because of a flood and previous erosion. And we were able to work after a flood in the spring of last year to get a waiver and permission from the Army Corps of Engineers and get the resources over there working with the county to secure that bridge. And thankfully that is still now open. But you know, these are the times it really is a critical reminder that it takes all of us at different levels. I've been in communication with the mayor, with, you know, state level officials and of course with my colleagues to figure out and community leaders to figure out where the needs are and what we can do to address them. Part of it is, of course, our amazing nonprofit organizations like the Red Cross and community faith-based organizations like Ebenezer Baptist Church that opened their doors and was taking in individuals in need and running and feeding people running on a generator that was powering part of their church. So it's you know, there's a lot that needs to be done, but I'm always encouraged when we see Oklahomans coming together. That's what we know we can do and we need to do. And as a member of Congress, I can and have and will continue to help facilitate federal funds to help with the cleanup efforts that we know are going to take some time. And you know, many people, I think you mentioned yourself included, have had significant damage. So that is going to take a bit, but we've all got to work together to make sure we get it taken care of.
That kind of leads into one of the other big things that a congressperson does, and that is assisting people with problems they have, veterans or Social Security issues, kinds of Medicare, Medicaid, any kind of interactions people might have with the federal government, small business assistance during this COVID crisis. If you could give us an overview of what your approach to that has been. And
I'm really proud of the work that we've done through my office in this first term. We're approaching about 3,000 Oklahomans, almost 3,000 Oklahomans that we've helped with a variety of issues. We're helping our veterans with getting VA benefits that they need. If they've had challenges getting the benefits that they're entitled to, being able to help a World War II veteran receive the medal that he had been awarded, but he'd never received, and we were able to present that to him earlier this year. We've also helped so many Oklahomans, especially our seniors with Social Security and Medicare. And since the beginning of this pandemic, we have been able to help hundreds and hundreds of Oklahomans with unemployment, especially to people who were self-employed or part-time workers, gig workers, and others who lost their jobs as a result of the pandemic. We have been able to help almost 1,000, and my office has personally, we've helped more than over 100 small businesses get the benefits and assistance they were entitled to when they were running into roadblocks. And I'm really proud of the work that we've done. And I'm continuing to push for more relief. But in a real way, it's helping Oklahomans. We've helped recover over $3.5 million in taxpayer dollars that they were entitled to. And you know, that's really what it's about.
So talking about Oklahoma jobs and employment. Apparently, you've cast some votes that are potentially harmful to the Oklahoma oil and gas industry. Please explain what's going on.
Let me be clear. Those allegations that I have harmed Oklahoma's oil and gas industry are patently false and have been roundly debunked. I have been a champion for pro-growth and pro-jobs policies in Congress and have been endorsed by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. The attacks that have been leveled against me are absolutely false. I have never voted against Oklahoma energy jobs, and I have been an advocate for our oil and gas industry. The votes that I'm being attacked on were to limit offshore drilling on the East Coast and to limit drilling in Anwar. I do my homework. There is not a single Oklahoma oil and gas company that has offshore drilling nor plans to drill in Anwar, and especially during a time when we know the oil and gas industry goes up and down, especially when we have seen prices go down. Increasing supply is actually more harmful to Oklahoma's oil and gas companies and jobs. And I cast those votes very intentionally not to harm Oklahoma's oil and gas industry. And let me be clear again, not a single Oklahoma company has offshore drilling interests. Those are multinational companies. Additionally, I have been an advocate for ensuring an all of the above approach in our energy sector and making sure that oil and gas is a part of that. I've stood up to leaders in my party when they wanted to propose a federal ban on fracking, and I opposed that. I introduced a bill that would invest more in our strategic petroleum reserve, especially earlier this year as the prices were dipping, to help our oil and gas industry. And I have called on the administration for investigations into Saudi Arabia's dumping, and have been a vocal advocate as a member of the member of the Oil and Gas Caucus about the important role that the natural gas plays in an all of the above energy approach that helps to ensure energy affordability and sustainability in our national security, as well as addressing critical environmental issues as we deal and tackle the important issue of climate change.
Are there any efforts to find a leader that would be more of a centrist than Nancy Pelosi? And why is she the one that you back over possibly finding someone that would be more of a centrist?
I'm the one on this ballot. Nancy Pelosi's not the one on this ballot. And unfortunately, these outside groups have decided they're going to run against somebody that's not on the ballot. I show up every day. I am fighting for Oklahomans, and I've stood up to my party when they were wrong, including the speaker. I'm fourth in the entire House caucus for voting against the speaker because I'm here to represent Oklahomans. But I've also have and will continue to work with people on both sides. People on both sides of the aisle when it's in the best interest of Oklahoma. That shows in my record. I've worked with the administration, I've worked with both parties, and I've had 25 bills that I've introduced or co-sponsored signed into law. That's a significant achievement in a divided Congress, and I think it's really important. And so many of the issues we face, and I think so many of the problems right now, come from this idea that we can't talk to each other and that we can't work with each other, and or this idea that we have to agree with someone and everything. I don't know anyone I agree with on everything. And that's why I take every single vote one at a time and do my best to make decisions in the best interest of Oklahoma. And I'm not afraid to vote against the speaker or stand up to the speaker. I'm also not afraid to work with Republicans and Democrats. As a member of the Bipartisan Problem Solvers Caucus, it's 25 Democrats and 25 Republicans. That's what we do. We work together. We don't agree on everything, but we come to solutions like our proposal for the next stimulus package, March to Common Ground stimulus package, which has bipartisan support. It's a reason I opposed the most recent bills that came out of the House, because it didn't meet what I call the three T's of good governance: timely, targeted, and transparent. That means it's got to be bipartisan. It's got to be focused on responding to the needs of the communities during this pandemic, and we've got to make sure that the money is being spent the way it needs to. And that's the thing that I think we really need to focus on. It's certainly the thing that I focus on day in and day out. And holding leadership on both sides accountable to me that's what our jobs are. And, when I talk to Oklahomans day in and day out, things that are most important to them, they tell me about their concerns about healthcare and about education and about jobs and economic opportunity. And those are the things that I focus on. And so let's talk about healthcare for a moment and what that means for Oklahomans. We're second in the nation for the highest rate of uninsured, behind only Texas. That has health and economic impacts for our businesses, for our families, and our future. And I believe that we absolutely have to protect the advancements that we've seen under the Affordable Care Act, including protecting people with pre-existing conditions and lifetime caps. You know, as Oklahomans, we just voted to expand Medicaid, which next year will provide an additional 200,000 Oklahomans healthcare that don't currently have it. And these are the working Oklahomans, the working poor that are that make too much to qualify currently for Medicaid, but don't make enough to qualify for some of the supports. And that's not very much, just to put that in context. So I don't think we have to throw out the systems that are in place, but we to fix them, we certainly should be fixing them. But I'm going to continue to fight to make sure that we protect those things, because it makes such a big difference.
In terms of education, what do you think the federal role of education is and is not?
Education is one of the best investments that we can make in our future, and it is absolutely critical that we do so in an intentional way. And I will always fight to ensure that public dollars go to public schools. The question about the role of the federal government is an important one. It's not to make individual curriculum decisions for our school districts. That we have amazing and qualified educators that can do that. And much of the responsibility, of course, falls to the state, but we have to make sure that we're investing sufficiently in all aspects of our public education. And I am a proud supporter and advocate of public education. In my first term, I have advocated for and was successful in last year's appropriations bills of getting record funding for Head Start and early Head Start programs, which are evidence-based programs that are proven, especially they serve our most marginalized and underserved communities, to have incredible follow-on benefits as these children get into schools. It's also school breakfast and lunch programs, especially in Oklahoma right now, where one in four Oklahoma children are food insecure. And the evidence is clear there. If children don't have enough food, they can't learn. You have to have bellies full so brains can grow and develop. I've also fought successfully for funding for impact aid schools, which we have many in Oklahoma, which are schools that have either tribal or federal land. So their funding streams are not as strong as they should be, as well as funding for students with disabilities. And I was successful I've been successful in pushing back at Betsy DeVos in a number of different ways, including when she made a decision earlier this year that would have taken $1 million from rural Oklahoma schools. I worked with my colleagues to make sure that decision wasn't arbitrarily put into place and hurting our rural schools. So I think that the role of education is absolutely a critical one, and I will always fight to make sure that public dollars go to public schools. And I'm proud to have the endorsement of the Oklahoma Education Association, as well as the American Federation of Teachers, Oklahoma and Oklahoma City chapters. And that's why I also fought to make sure that we had funding in the CARES Act that went to public schools. And I've introduced a bill in the House to provide hazard pay for our educators just during this pandemic when they are in person. I think we need to make sure that we're trusting our educators, giving them the ability to make decisions that are right for our communities, which have unique and individual needs. But our federal programs are particularly critical in communities that are marginalized, and especially where the disparities in income and accessibility for resources are vastly different.
And looking at some of that federal aid and the COVID again, I know that first package is mostly used up. I think there's a little bit of PPP funds that are currently locked up and they're not able to use, but there also has been a lot of talk about an additional round of support. And I know our small businesses really have been helped by what's been done so far, but could certainly use. I am very sad about the number of small businesses that have already closed forever. Yeah. As a result of that, and that makes me very sad. What are you doing to advance the additional support?
Jill, I share your concerns about that and have since the very beginning. You're correct. In the CARES Act, that's where, you know, and the other pieces that we've passed this year, we were able to provide critical support through the Paycheck Protection Program, which I was strong advocate of and helped to push through in the House and make sure that we were investing in our small businesses. And once that passed, working with small businesses to get those funds, but additionally working with my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to push through the Paycheck Protection Program Flexibility Act, which provided additional resources and support for our small businesses and flexibility, moving from 8 weeks to 24 weeks and doing other things, as well as getting additional funding in there. And since then, I have continued to advocate both for investing in our businesses, but also making sure that we are filling the other critical buckets that need to be addressed with respect to relief. I want to say a couple things with respect to that. You're right that we need to do more. Unfortunately, there are businesses that have been significantly impacted and continue to be impacted. I have led the way on a number of different bills and worked with my colleagues, including the Restart Act, the Save Our Stages Act, advocating for additional funding for airlines and other significantly impacted industries, as well as our small businesses, our independent venues and restaurants, travel and tourism industry, and more. And we'll continue to do that. But what we need right now, again, is a package that is timely, targeted, and transparent. And I've called out leadership and pushed back on leadership in the House and in the Senate and on both sides of the aisle when they are playing partisan games. I voted against the two bills, the HEROES Act and the second version of the HEROES Act in the House, not because they didn't have critical funding for small businesses and other needs, but because they didn't meet the three T's, timely, targeted, and transparent. They weren't bipartisan. It had unrelated provisions in it, and there was no way it was going to make it across the finish line. Same thing happened in some of the provisions from the Senate. But what I have done is stay at the table with my colleagues in the Bipartisan Problem Solvers Caucus and work to create solutions. I think Oklahomans are tired of people pointing fingers and pushing the blame in different directions. And what they want are problem solvers. And what we did as problem solvers was we stayed at the table. We kept pushing leadership on both sides. And we came up with what we called a framework that's the March to Common Ground framework, which includes critical funding for our significantly impacted businesses, even if they've applied for and received previous rounds of funding, especially for those that were amongst the first to close and will be amongst the last to reopen. And so we could use things like a test of, okay, how much have you been impacted, giving additional flexibility. But our package also included additional stimulus checks and extension, I think, in the thoughtful way of unemployment to help people who have lost jobs through no fault of their own, as well as continued investment in health and investment in state and local governments. So our cities and municipalities and other local governments, especially in places like Oklahoma, that rely on sales tax, don't have to cut our first responders and things like that. It also included some, I think, thoughtful liability protections that we negotiated, as well as funding for schools and other critical resources. And that's the way we have to do it, because the needs are great and they're varied, and we need to make sure that we're filling all of those buckets. We're not going to get anything that's perfect, but we still haven't walked away. And as problem solvers, we're continuing to push leadership to get to a deal that helps Oklahomans, that helps our businesses, that helps our families. And I think that's what it's going to take. And I'll tell you, one of the things that's the most frustrating to me is to watch people on both sides of the aisle play games with this.